So you mentioned the beer mile, and you are, do you know the world record holder? Is this someone that you personally know?
Yeah, I've come to know him. Corey Bellamore. He's a University of Windsor track athlete, cross country guy. He just missed going to the Olympics this year.
How old is he?
My guess is 21, 22.
Ah, he's a baby.
Yeah.
I definitely don't know him.
Yeah. So, probably a couple months ago, a buddy called him up and just said, hey, we're going to go do the beer mile tonight. So he came over with six beers, or I think it's four beers. He had to buy six.
Yeah.
And, just after dinner, they went to the track out in Tecumseh, and they went and ran it, and he broke the record. So the record, I don't know exactly the number, but it's in the 430s.
That's
so
unbelievable.
I think maybe 439 or something like that.
I couldn't run a mile being chased by a grizzly.
So is it like you drink all six beers then?
No, man.
It's actually four beers. So he had to buy six, but you need four for the mile. And what they do is... you start by drinking a beer. It's got to be a full, legitimate 5% beer.
Right.
It used to be. I thought it had to be in a
can. American beer.
I thought it had to be in a can, but it's changed. It's a bottle as well. And they measure what's left in the bottle afterwards to make sure that you actually, you know, consumed enough.
Right.
So you down the beer, you run a lap, so 400 meters. You get back to that place, you open the beer, you down another beer, do it
run
again,
another lap,
and wow. You do that for a total of four. And he did all of that in under 4 minutes, 40 seconds.
Are you kidding me?
Or 40 seconds.
4 minutes.
Yeah.
I did the beer mile back in, I think my second year university with track, and just a bunch of us got together, and it was a kind of an annual thing that we did. And, I remember how uncomfortable of a feeling that was. You know, running a mile in general for a multi-eventer is something that you don't really want to do anyway.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But interluding it with the chug, that the chugging was the only thing that kept me in the running.
Yeah.
Amongst the elite of our cross country team, and I remember a couple guys, and I know there's a penalty. Like if you throw up, I believe either you have to chug another beer, or if like there was all these rules that I was told.
Yeah,
we're kind of like gross and a little vulgar, but I remember at the last lap, I kind of threw up a little bit in my mouth, and I remember just saying, either I spit this out and I run another lap, or I just take care of it and down it.
Suck
and
it
was pretty awful.
Yeah,
I can't remember the time, but all I know is that I was pretty wrecked after. But that's unbelievable. So Windsor, Ontario is host to the world record.
Yeah, it's a world record.
World record beer mile.
Yeah, the cool thing is after he posted that, they posted it that night. He got a call from an organization in London, England, that was actually hosting the world championship of beer mile. Who knew there was a thing, right? So they had a whole event, and they had invited the best in the world at this.
Sure.
And they said, if you get on a plane, we'll pay for all your expenses. You just get on the plane. So he bit. He went on. And I think he went a couple seconds faster. And you guys got to go watch the video because
I'm definitely going to watch the video.
The one in London was really cool because you've got these people that are at the line drinking maybe their third beer. And here he comes and he's taking their fourth beer and drinking it. And they looked at him and it was like this respect, like, wow.
That is a little disbelief, right?
So yeah. Not only is he like the fastest guy out there, he's also like the fastest chugger out there. So like that's like a double skill.
His skill set is
incredibly
deep.
Incredibly efficient.
I'm not going to lie. That would be at the top of my resume if I applied somewhere. Like, you know, university degree, double degree, and then beer mile world record holder. Yeah. I can chug really fast and I'm a fast runner. I think I could see in the door.
Yeah, and you know, the guy's an amazing athlete, right? So just a hair from going to the games this year in Rio. He's one of the best cross country guys around. We were talking, you know, afterwards. So Corey reached out to me previously, and we just, you know, we didn't work together, you know, on that first, and we knew of each other. And then I saw the beer mile, and we were at the triathlon, Tecumseh Triathlon, and I saw him there, and I just had to go talk to him and say, hey,
congratulations.
Yeah. So I said, you know, we've lost a couple athletes, in that, you know, they've graduated, you know, they're not in sport anymore. We've got a bit of room on our roster. Would you be interested in, you know, us fueling you? So he was game for that.
That's awesome.
You know, so we love helping out, you know, local athletes, you know, so we work with Melissa and Noelle and the Spitz. Yeah. And so when we can connect with local athletes, you know, help build our brand, help make them better athletes, it's a perfect scenario.
That's awesome. There's, well, I guess we should probably introduce what's going on here.
I was just
going
to say that.
So we're here at Infinit Nutrition Canada with CEO, correct? CEO, the man in charge, the big wig, Darcy Haggath. And we thank you for being here.
No problem.
Of course, I am your host of the Full Depth Podcast. What's going on, everybody? I'm Tyler Ray. Here with, as always, Handsome Mike on the mic.
What's going on, everybody? I am not going to spit a jam.
You're not
going
to spit a jam?
Or whatever they say. What is it? Spit a...
That was like a dad comment. I'm not going to spit a jam. We're happy to be here, Darcy. Thank you for joining us today.
No problem.
And we're going to find out a little bit about what you got going on behind these walls and all the stuff in between. So, Darcy, for those of you who don't, for those of people that don't know who you are, probably everybody else other than the two of us on this podcast currently, tell us a bit about yourself, Infinit Nutrition, and how you ended up here.
Involved in athletics all my life, never at an, you know, an elite level, was that, you know, travel hockey guy that wanted to make AAA and just, you know, a notch below that, but, had a great family. They supported me, you know, running me around the rinks, you know, from 5 years until I even remember my mom watching me at rec hockey. You know, I'm 24 years old playing rec hockey. She's there in the stands cheering me on. So
the love and support of a mother.
Yeah. I had lots of support from mom and dad, and was always involved in sport. So as I became the, you know, a little more seasoned, you know, I was looking to stay fit. I think over a beer at a, you know, Christmas party, I agreed to do my first marathon. So that goes back probably 2000, 2001. So I wanted to get back into some sort of fitness. And for me, having a goal is always important. If I'm just training to train, I'm not nearly as effective as I've got, you know, some sort of goal. So I did, you know, a marathon. I followed an 18-week program. Just consistently, you know, did it. And, you know, I ran my first marathon, you know, a little bit under 4 hours.
You still remember that experience.
I was hooked. Yeah. And then I got involved in, I was really into cycling, mountain biking, really enjoyed that, but was really drawn to triathlon. I don't know if you guys have seen the NBC, you know, shows. Mm-hmm. Often on a Sunday, they'll show, you know, what happened about a month ago, and they would show the highlights of the race. And I just found it fascinating that people would, you know, go so long in these triathlons. You know, some people are going, you know, the elite are going 8 hours, and then some people are taking upwards to 17 hours to finish.
That's unbelievable.
I was mesmerized by it, and I said to my dad, you know, I want to do that someday. So at the time I was riding a mountain bike, and you know, I didn't want to go and buy like a road bike or anything like that. I just, you know, wanted to do it with the equipment I had.
Sure.
I found Xterra. That's an off-road triathlon. And there was one actually close to here. I was in London at the time and Picnic, Michigan. Great trails there. Silver Lake. That's where they hosted that triathlon. So first one I did was there, and I have to say I was hooked. And, you know, from there, I started, I did a half marathon or half Ironman, and then I moved to the full distance.
So what's, break down a half Ironman for us.
Half Ironman, you start off with a 1.9 kilometer swim, then you cycle.
Is that open water or is that pool
swim? Yeah, it's open water.
Okay.
And, you know, it's funny you should say that because is a big difference between swimming, following a black line in the pool, and then going out into, you know, an open lake.
And having a landmark and all that.
Oh, yeah, you're looking across to see if, where that boy is.
So yeah, exactly.
My first, I was all over. I think I, you know, it was a mile swim, the Xterra event. I probably swam 1.2 miles. You know, it was a two-loop course. Almost got lapped by the, you know, the first people.
Wow.
And I was... I think second last out of the water that day. Makes it really easy to find your bike.
Exactly. I think it's that one.
Yeah, there it is. So back to the half Ironman. It's 1.9 kilometer swim, 90 bike, 90 kilometer bike, and then a half marathon or, you know, 13 miles thereabouts.
Damn. Oh. So just a little bit of work, basically.
Yeah, it did that up in Ottawa, and I knew that the next year... That'd
be beautiful up there.
Yeah, it's along the Rideau Canal.
Beautiful.
It was an awesome venue. It's a criterium course, 15 kilometers, you do it 7 times, and, you know, on the bike, and, you know, then you've got this, you know, half marathon to run, and... Okay. You know, it went pretty well. It was a good stepping stone. I knew the following year I was already signed up for Lake Placid and to do my first Ironman. And that was really my goal.
How did you find training sort of by yourself, probably with a group of people, and then competing with like, massive amounts of people that are starting at the same time? Like, how did you cope with that in terms of kind of like training by yourself day in, day out, and then having to compete with so many?
Yeah, that's a good question. You know, training on your own, like the first couple of years of my Ironman training was all on my own. So you do, you know, lots of sentry rides, 100-mile rides. You're out on the bike for 5-6 hours. You know, I was really driven. I was just, you know, really into it. You can't half-ass it. You have to really want it, you know, to go out. So I was okay with those, you know, those times where I was alone. When you get into a race scenario, there's just an excitement, you know, that's attached to it. You got helicopter, you know, that's at the start line and you're like, whoa, where am I?
Adrenaline's pumping. You're ready to go.
This is really cool. I'm a, you know, a fair swimmer at best. So I'll come out of the middle of the pack in the swim. But I'm a little bit better cyclist. So it's really fun for me because I get to pass all those, you know, swimmers that are much better than I am. So it's motivating to go through
little
the race.
Little cat and mouse the whole time.
Yeah. So you're definitely doing your own race out there. You know, but it is really cool to have that many people. Like most Ironmans today, there's, you know, and the ones I did were about 2,000 people all on the course at the same time. So, you know... definitely a contrast, but race day is really it's more of a celebration. It's hard to explain. Yeah. Like people say, well, how can you do that? Race day is the fun part. All the time that you put into it,
that's the true competition, really. Yeah, if you think about it,
if you've done it, you know, well, you'll actually really enjoy race day, and it'll just be, you know, you're out there for a day and, you know, it's a riot.
Yeah
Cool. So part way along, I did I think 3 Ironmans.
These are full. Like you did, you eventually got into the full Ironman.
Yeah, my first one was in 2001. I did Lake Placid actually 6 years in a row. First one was, frankly, an eye opener. You know, I remember running with walking with a guy from California and another guy from Boston, and all three of us were on the back side of the course, and we said, you know, never again. We're never going to do this again. Really? We all agreed. Walked a lot. Didn't know people walked on the Ironman. You know, it was a bit of a death march. And you know, by the time I woke up the next day, I knew I was signing up again, and I signed up the next day. So it really had me. So. First year, eye-opener. Next year, I got my time down under 12 hours. You know, so I went from 13:40 thereabouts down to under 12.
Right, an hour's huge.
Yeah. Then the next year, I got to about 11:30, and I just felt like I was being held back, even though that was a good performance. Nutritionally, I wasn't getting enough calories in. You know, I wasn't enjoying my nutrition near the end, you know, the fourth hour of the bike, fifth hour of the bike. It wasn't going down on a warmer day.
And what are you consuming? Like during a course, like obviously you're competing for 11, 12 hours. I mean, that you can't go without food for 11 or 12 hours. What are you intaking like on a course?
So by the time I did that Ironman, I was on all liquid nutrition. So I was using Hammer products. I think they're, you know, a good company. They do some things really well. So I was taking Perpetuum and Sustain Energy, two of their products, mixing a bit of gel in there with some, you know, they have what's called salt tabs. So I was making a concoction out of that. And I had learned at a training camp that liquid is the way to go. If you go all liquid, you're going to get more calories in than you otherwise would if you're actually taking a solid food. If you're eating a solid food, it actually takes energy to break that food down. And generally solids, there's more to break down, so you don't get those nutrients until later.
And gastric emptying is even slower. So then you're missing the whole point of that.
Exactly. And that's, I think, what I was running into with the Hammer products is gastric emptying wasn't happening as quickly as I needed it to. So I was getting backed up and therefore not getting enough calories mm-hmm. in. So I was topping out about 300 calories. So if you think about, you know, you're taking in 300 calories an hour for, you know, 11 hours, 12 hours, you're going to hit a time where Absolutely. You're out of glycogen and you're Right. surviving on fat, which is an okay energy source. But there's an oxygen debt if you try to keep the same pace as if you were, you know, burning fast, fast burning fuel like Right. glycogen or Sure. carbohydrates. So I knew that I needed something else. And, you know, in the triathlon world there's a forum called Slow Twitch. And it's the forum for triathletes. And many triathletes, me included back then, spend way too much time on it. We should be training more. Instead, yeah. we're reading and, you know. So a lot of type A personalities. And, you know, I found out about this product called Infinit Nutrition. And their claim was that we're going to make a drink that's specific to your body, the way you sweat, your body composition, maybe the saltiness of your sweat, mm-hmm. Your flavor preferences, and what you're trying to achieve, whether you're a short distance athlete or long distance. Mm-hmm. And
like a fully customizable
yeah. and supplement. I thought, well, gee, that sounds really cool. Mm-hmm. But I think this is a little far-fetched.
Skeptical, right?
I was very. Yeah. But I continued to research, learned a little more, and I ordered. So I ordered my first. I went online, I customized, and you know I started using it in preparation for my 2005 Ironman, and I have to say it made such a difference in my training. So the way I could go, especially in my century rides, like I was able to power through that fourth and fifth hour differently than I had before. And probably more notably was the way I recovered. Right. So yeah. I always take a recovery drink after, but getting in those calories, like 400 calories an hour and the right, you know, electrolytes, I didn't have as big of a hole mm-hmm. As when I was getting home previously. Right. So my recovery went upwards, a lot, and so too did my performance. So 2005, I had a great Ironman. I remember telling my dad that, you know, I had gone 11:30 and I told him I was going to go 10:45 and, my dad believes in me, but he's like, oh, I don't know.
Stretch.
Yeah. Yeah. And it was a big goal. And I had this goal plastered all around my house. I had it in my workout room, mm-hmm. had it in the bathroom and in the kitchen. Everybody knew what my goal was 10:45. And, I nailed it. I got 10:45.
That's perfect.
I remember a rookie mistake by a veteran, I guess. I didn't have my wheel magnet on my race wheel. It was on my training wheel, so I had no data how fast I was going. So I had a decent swim.
And that's huge if you guys have ever done any road biking to yeah. have that sensor to make sure you can pace yourself correctly.
I've got no data. So I laughed at myself. I'm going down by the ski jumps. This is Lake Placid, the Olympics.
I love it there.
I thought, okay, we'll just ride.
Yeah.
So now it became almost a superstition for me. I did not want to know what time it was. So you do two loops mm-hmm. on the bike. The first loop comes up and they're showing you your time. And I didn't look. And I was like, la, la, la.
I'm just going to keep biking. In your zone at that moment because you probably trained so often in that pacing that you just knew your zone.
I did.
And if you could just kind of forget about the data and what pace I need to hit on, that zone is probably what you were so accustomed to that it's probably easier for you to get into that zone without having to.
I think it was. I was like every night I went to bed, like this is not a lie. Every yeah. night I went to bed, I visualized mm-hmm. that race and I went to bed in a happy place and I went over it, 10:45 and I could see it. So when I didn't have any data, mm-hmm. That was, fine. I didn't think that it would pan out the way it did. But yeah. So I get her off the bike for my second loop. Again, I don't look, I don't want to know. And I just went and ran a marathon. And the way the race finishes, your family can come out. So my son, Matthew, mm-hmm. he would always come out and run, part of this Olympic oval with yeah. me. And we get run around the bend and he says, come on, Dad, come on. And he says, we can still make your goal. And we look. And on the scoreboard, on the clock, it said 10:44:49.
Wow.
And we're less than, you know, like I think we had 40 meters, yeah. Even the state that I was in. Yeah. And we crossed the line at 10:45.
And that's when the
zero,
music.
Zero.
And that's when the music starts going, right?
Yeah. Isn't that crazy? Like
you channel like your inner Usain Bolt for that last 40 meters, high stepping.
Yeah. So to have no data and, you know,
and it
so
just land there.
I just really believe in setting intentions and,
You know, it's like Kindred. It was like meant to happen.
Yeah. So wow. I sometimes have to catch myself, you know, you can take that outside of sport and apply it. Like if there's something that you want in your personal life, in your business, well, just say it out loud, tell someone, you know, what you're thinking, why, if it's good, good natured, if it's, you know, for the better good, I think people will help out.
And the more you're focused on something positive, the less negative you're going to be doing, right? So if you're constantly complaining about something, you're not going to achieve your goal. So
absolutely,
I mean, like the more you do something positive, the more it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Little side note before we get into more topics of Infinit Nutrition, it kind of made me about like thinking about it. I was at a seminar and there was a therapist that did a lot of kind of psychotherapy, but also sort of like spiritual therapy. And she cited this research of, I think it was a Japanese or a Chinese scientist who, if you took the water that you drank and you put it on to, let's say like you wanted like a Ferrari, you put it on top of a Ferrari, those positive ions will go into the water. And then the more you drink of it, the more you'll become it. Or if you had like a goal to you know, run a marathon, and they actually had studies on this, or I'm not sure what kind of studies, believe it if you want or not, but
yeah.
But I guess like the more those that water touched whatever your goal was, the more it would happen. So I thought it was kind of interesting. So now
I'm about to put my water on your Jeep out there. Right now. It's a nice. I was talking about his Jeep when I walked in. So I'm just gonna start taking my water on all the shit that I want, and I think it'll work out in the long run. Yeah. I think it really boils down to accountability.
Yeah.
And when you say it out loud, the more you're accountable to your goals, the more readily they're, you know, you access them in your active mind, and then.
For sure.
There you go, man. You land 10:45.
Yeah. When you say it out loud, you know, people are expecting something of you. So you want it yourself, but you also don't want to let those people down that, hey, he said he wanted to go 10:45. You know, so you can see that moment celebrating with them of, you know, something of accomplishment. So
that's amazing.
Yeah. So that was 2005. And then, you know, kind of back to Infinit. I used it again for 2006, of course. But this is the thing that happened that, you know, got me involved with Infinit. It was, you know, companies in Cincinnati, Ohio. That's where it was founded. Michael Follin and the team there, good group. My product didn't come. I'm 2 weeks outside of, you know, my 2006 Ironman, and I'm crapping.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know, because you know, nutrition is such a big part of performing, and it's what you're used to. It's what you know. I can't change this up, you know, just ahead
of this
race.
The last thing you want.
And you can't just go and buy a custom blend
off
a retailer's, you know, it would have to revamp my total. So I got on the phone with him. I tried not to be panicked. I probably was.
Starcy here. Just wondering.
No big deal. If I can get it, that'd be great. Maybe right now, that'd be awesome.
Exactly. So they were really cool. Mike, I talked to Mike and he said, listen, we're going to be at the expo, you know, Placid. We'll make sure that we bring, you know, two of your, you know, your blends. Mm-hmm. You'll have lots of nutrition. Don't worry about it. So it was actually that interaction. When we talked, I learned that, you know, it's a bit of a challenge for him across the border, you know, trying to get a white powder across the border. Who knew?
Yeah.
But his customer service for Canadians was very poor because of the, you know, the border shipping was really expensive. And there was just a seed planted. And I can't remember ever coming back to that seed. But by November of that year, we opened our doors. You know, so we started this business in November 2006. And have to say that I romanticized. I thought, oh, this is going to be cool because I'm gonna, you know, live and breathe sport all the time. I'm gonna make my livelihood.
Visions of grandeur.
You know, doing that. You know, I was still, you know, a senior level manager in a pharmaceutical company, AccuCaps here in town. Many good friends to this day. Great company. Loved working there. You know, I went in and told my boss, I said, listen, you know, I started this company, you know, I'm not going anywhere. You know, think of it more of a hobby. I won't let it get in the way of my performance, as a leader. And so that just kind of continued on. So I ran Infinit in my spare time. So time that I might've trained before now was invested in driving this business, you know, trying to get it to where it could be. And then you fast forward to, you know, 2013, the business had grown, you know, quite a lot, and really through, you know, organically, word of mouth, people hearing about what we do, you know, Canadian Sport Institute, these are the folks that support our Olympic athletes. They learned of us in 2008 and we became partnered, you know, along that path. So now we're fueling Olympic athletes, you know, Canada's best. And so it was great, but things were getting a little bit out of control. My life balance was, you know, truly out of whack, because I've got, you know, a job that I'm doing 10 plus hours a day. You know, I've got a, you know, large.
In itself, it's busy as it.
So I got that. Then there's the demands of Infinit. And from a personal standpoint, I'm no longer training or just, you know, doing a little bit. So, you know, the type of training, you go out and you're sore because you're trying to be something you were before. You know, so we went on a vacation. And we took a friend to Vegas for his 50th, and Brenda and I, my wife, we just, you know, we chatted on the plane. Just said, you know, what if, you know, and you know, we ran some numbers, and we had everything we needed and wanted, but we didn't have enough time. So we just said, well, why don't we take a step back? Why don't we, you know, go all in this business? And so we made that decision on that trip. Came back, gave my notice. I gave 3 months so that, you know, they had some time to transition. And July 2013 is when we went, you know, full time. I went full time.
Right.
We had other full time members, but I would say that I'm the driving force as far as relationship building, marketing, building the brand. And since that's happened, things have really gone well. Yeah.
I mean, I became aware of you more so in the past couple of years, as your reach started to grow on social media, and you know, with the fitness industry being booming here, especially in Windsor, you know, people like you, Mike, and Bobby over at Workhorse, representing your product, and just forming these wonderful relationships with different industry leaders, as well as athletes that are going places. You know, Melissa Bishop, Noelle Moncombe, who I both had the opportunity to train with over the years. And I really feel that you've done a great job of latching on to individuals that represent what you stand for here at Infinit, which is that, you know, positive, forward-driven and thinking attitude. So
that's really crazy, you know, like we've got elite athletes in our backyard. You don't know them because, you know, you're so busy working. I wasn't really in tune with the community. And as soon as, you know, I no longer had this full-time gig over here and I was focused on Infinit, now I could start to have some conversations and, you know, just be present. And these things just kind of, you know, came to us. You know, someone like Melissa, you know, here's an athlete that, you know, was, you know, even back then, like we hadn't worked together for a long time. We've been together, I think, for, I think we're going on 3 years now. You know, she wasn't fueling optimally, you know, lots of support, but she still probably wasn't hydrating to the level that she should, you know, taking something, you know, maybe during some of the training to manage calorie deficit and then the recovery afterwards. You know, and just through some conversation, you know, we were able to close that gap for her. And, you know, what I'm very proud about is our relationships are really genuine. They're not because there's a great athlete over here. Hey, we want you to represent our brand. That's not what happens. What happens is we help an athlete that hasn't yet reached, you know, maybe their fullest potential. We help them get there, and it's a sincere, genuine relationship.
Growth with the company.
Yeah, we both benefit.
You were saying that when I came in a couple of weeks ago. You were telling me about how, you know, what you really pride yourself on is that the athletes that you do associate with, it's not so much they get to a level and then you approach them like a lot of the big, the bigger companies will, you know, grab an elite level athlete and say, hey, do you want to represent our business? And here's some money to say you use it. and I'll give you some product, where you guys would much rather and prefer to have an athlete utilize a product through their training and progress with it, so that when they do eventually represent you, it's a true, genuine,
reciprocal relationship. That's our model. I mean, you know, we recently lost, you know, a really high end, you know, CrossFit guy that, you know, was at the games last year.
Brent, correct?
Did really well. Yeah. And I don't want to, you know, call him out.
Sure. That's all fine.
You know, he's at a point in his career where he deserves, some recognition, and, you know, in our world, recognition does come with, you know, finances
of
and,
course.
You know, so we weren't able to continue to, you know, partner with him. You know, so that was, I understand it. You know, we left on, you know, really good terms, and I'm really happy for him. He's doing what's, you know, good for him.
And he seems like a wonderful, genuine individual, just from what I've gathered through
the streams. He's awesome. Got such a big engine. He had some limiters. He worked on those. He's so focused, and, you know, I'm really happy for what's, you know, happened for him, and, you know, really grateful that we were, you know, able to help him, you know, through, you know, a couple years as he went from, you know, just missing regionals to, you know, where, you know, I know what he was fueled on when he, you know, was at the game.
Right,
so that was, you know, really cool.
He plays fourth this year too.
Yeah,
which is
he was amazing. Yeah.
And he won like four of the events.
He won a lot
of unbelievable. So,
and he's a specimen. Like, you know, you get lucky to be partnered with some of these folks. Mm-hmm. You know, we can't make someone, you know, something that they're not.
Of course.
We can only support what they do, and what they want to do. So, yeah, so most of the athletes that we work with, you know, are athletes that are, you know, we're trying to get to that next level, and yeah, it's been fun. We've got so many great athletes in this neck of the woods, you know, with Noelle, her year this year, going to the games. You know, I remember we watched it in the boardroom when she qualified, and, you know, we were jumping up and down. Like, I don't think she had a more complete race ever.
Right.
Watching her go over each hurdle, she was clean, clean, clean.
Right.
And it was amazing to see.
She's a real testament to hard work. I've seen her grow over the years as well, and she's always been the one that would just put in the work required. And it shows, I mean, especially when she gets partnered up with someone like you, and you can refuel properly.
Yeah.
Because I think it's like genetics only take you so far, right? Like, and you find a lot of these elite level athletes have just kind of milked like the tank, right? It's empty in terms of their ability to stretch themselves naturally.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's something like Infinit and the customizable products that you provide that really kind of, like you said, they fill in the gaps.
Yeah.
And take them to the next level. Well,
and so many great athletes in the area that nobody really knew how to fuel themselves, right?
Yeah.
So they had great, you know, track coaches or great, you know, coaches in terms of even trainers, but nobody really could pinpoint, you know, hey, how much salt are you losing, or how much carbs do you need during your training? So I feel like you bridge that gap really nicely between, you know, the great athletes that we have, but then also their recovery.
Yeah, and that's what's, you know, kind of neat about triathletes are so anal, if you will, they're type A. They've done a lot of work nutritionally to pave the way for other athletics. So we really learned about nutrition trying to fuel an Ironman athlete. But what we learned along the way, especially after getting partnered with Canadian Sport Institute, is we can be more than just an endurance nutrition provider. We can fuel someone that's doing strength work, a heavyweight rower. You know, these guys are putting in so much volume. Getting them recovered after is so important. So I think our company kind of migrated, but we became aware that we could, you know, we've got so much more than just fueling someone during event. And that's when recovery really became a big part of our game. You know, the protein that you use, you know, the ingredients, it's so important that, you know, you start off with, you know, great ingredients. And then if you actually combine them so that your body can, you know, really utilize them, then you've got something that's,
absolutely,
you know, that's good. So
let's talk about the protein since we're on that topic. So, there are many forms of protein, and so like a lot of our listeners or viewers, you know, go to the big supplement stores and they see a ton of protein with a nice flashy labels. Can you talk about certain, aspects of what protein should be composed of, or what are some good protein sources out there when you're looking for a supplement?
Yeah, I mean, I would say the gold standard in athletics to support athletics is a whey isolate, you know, and the most pure whey isolate that you can possibly get. We source from New Zealand. People might hear New Zealand, grass fed, and I think that people recognize that and they need that. Maybe they don't know why. So New Zealand, their dairy protocols are superior to anyone in the world. So they only allow the cattle to free range. So they're out there feeding on grasses. There's no GMO involved in the feed. There's no growth hormone involved. And I think it's the fact that the animal is not stressed out all the time, maybe in a pen. They're more relaxed. Mm-hmm. And, I don't know the physiology around this, but cortisol, we know that cortisol can play a big, have a big impact on our lives if we're constantly stressed.
Right.
I think the same too is probably, the case for,
I'd imagine
this scenario. So the resulting milk is a much higher quality from, cattle in New Zealand. And then the purification process for the company that we work with is, really superior. So the resulting protein that comes out is 93% to 94% pure protein. That is an isolate. So the definition, so for your viewers, listeners, an isolate has to be 90% or higher.
In terms of its biological value, basically.
Protein content. So, you take 100 grams of this substance that is called protein, but 90% of that has to be actual functional protein. And that's the amino acids that, make up the protein. A concentrate is 80%. So it's between 80 and 90. So you see lots of tricks on, protein labels, and it drives me nuts. You'll see a blend, proprietary blend.
I can't stand proprietary blends.
And they'll
talked about this before.
They'll lead with, a whey isolate and a concentrate. So together they made this proprietary blend. The best you can do is if it was all an isolate.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So when, they're just marketing and using, the labeling rules to their benefit.
Of course.
I admire them for doing that. But the best is, to buy the purest form of the protein.
So the other 20-10% of that is what? Fat, lactose,
exactly.
Water?
Two things. It can be moisture.
Okay.
So there's always going to be a moisture, involved. But the two things that are important from, how the protein tastes, how it mixed, how it works, is really the fat and the lactose. Mm-hmm. So many people will say, I feel, bloated after I take away isolate.
I'm one of them. Yeah.
Yeah.
Gassy.
Is
one big one.
But if you take, really good quality protein, that all the lactose has been removed through the extraction process and all the fats or nearly all of them, then it's going to mix really well. Mm-hmm. The taste is going to be, next to nothing. Mm-hmm. Like you can take, a raw protein that we have, put it in water.
Drink it that way.
Yeah. It mixes in really nice. And we'll have people that say, well, I'm lactose intolerant, and I'll twist their arm a little bit. I'll say, listen, our guarantee, we'll replace it. We'll, free. Try this because I know it's better for athletics if you can get a whey isolate. Mm-hmm. I'm almost a plant guy. Most of my diet comes from, plant foods. I was using a plant proteins for a while, but I found for me that I couldn't get the same benefit as I was out of a whey isolate for my athletics. So that's one of the things that I do take that's animal based. It just really works for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice.
Okay. So looking out for elements such as the quantity and quality of protein involved. So isolate number one, number two, make sure that it is at least 90% pure. Does it have, it has to be qualified isolate. If they put isolate on a container,
correct,
by law or regulation, that is 90%.
It's 90%.
Pure.
Yeah.
Okay.
Then the next, so you'll find some that will just, scrape by. Of course, right? You're going to see some at 90, 91. Mm-hmm. I have never seen a protein with a higher purity than, our C of A's come in. They're often upwards to 94%.
Right.
The lower limit for the company we work with is 93%, but it's always between 93 and 94%.
Wow.
The other thing that's really important, and Dr. Trent Stellingworth, he's a physiologist and one of the best here in Canada. He works out in Victoria. I remember he popped up in a presentation I was doing. He learned that we were using, you know, this protein, and he was like just singing the praises. And he told me that it has a leucine content of 14.3% for 100 grams. That's higher than any protein on the market. It doesn't matter what source, mm-hmm. what brand, you won't find a higher leucine content than that. And you know, we know why that's important. It's because leucine, the science today tells us that leucine, you know, you'll hear about branched chain amino acids, you know, isoleucine, valine, mm-hmm. leucine. Those other ones are there, kind of they're saying now, along for the ride. It's really leucine that drives muscle protein synthesis. Mm-hmm. So the higher content you can get in a protein of leucine, the better your muscle protein synthesis is, which is essentially recovery. Mm-hmm. So after we traumatize a muscle, we work a muscle, it's going to repair itself stronger if there's, you know, the right nutrients present. Mm-hmm. The right nutrients is all about leucine, and you know, obviously you need other things. Carbohydrates right. are important too, but look for a leucine content.
Very good. Cool. Mm-hmm. Now, for an individual putting, like, we've spoke primarily on athletics-based and sport-based protein mm-hmm. supplementation. So now, does the isolate weigh and does it work well for the average, like the average fitness guru, gym goer? Like, is that a good source of protein for them, or should they be, you know, somewhere in between? Or what are your thoughts on that?
That's a good question. You know, for many reasons, yes, it's, you know, it's the right choice. I think first and foremost is taste and compliance to a product. If it's something that you enjoy taking, you can mix in with, you know, whether it's pre-mixed, like with some flavors, like a chocolate or something like that, or right. you're going to add it to some cereal or, you know, a smoothie, you want it to taste good. Right. You want it to mix well, because then you're more likely to, you know, consume it. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's important. You know, the whole leucine content is important to everyday folks. Like, yeah. I don't know if you guys realize that there's stats out there that says, and I'm in this category, I'm in my fifth decade, so I'm almost getting to my sixth. Yeah. The stats are that you'll lose 7% body fat per decade, each decade from 40 to 50, 50 to 60, 60 to 70. So if you're losing 70% of lean muscle mass, think about, you know, our ability mm-hmm. to be mobile, to mm-hmm. stay out on trails. And mm-hmm. So that's average. So if you're not doing anything different, and then anything different is we should be exercising a little bit, right. You know, routinely, mm-hmm. and we should be getting a little bit more protein in our diet than we used to, because our system becomes a little bit blunted. Mm-hmm. So our ability to use protein, it diminishes. So we actually have to take a little bit more protein to get the same net effect as we did when we were younger. Everyday people, like people that just want to live their everyday lives, introducing a little bit more protein in their diet. And I'm a real food first guy. Right. You know, I'll tell you, you know, look at your diet first. And, you know, if you're like, I try to get about 0.7 grams per pound
right.
Of, you know, protein in my diet daily. Mm-hmm. So I try to do that with real food first. If there's a gap, I try to tweak it,
right.
get it back up. There's still a gap. Then that's when I'll introduce something like, you know, raw protein mm-hmm. into my diet. Mm-hmm. So I'm just getting a little bit more. So know your target, and then, you know, try to tweak your, you know, diet to get it in. If not, then, you know, turn to a product that's got, you know, good quality protein to get it in.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. So protein, in your opinion, then would be that primary focal point for people when they're introducing themselves, say, into the sport supplement world. Like, that's kind of where you're looking first and foremost, that most people kind of have a little bit of a gap or a need for external sources of protein, whether it's through extra food or through protein supplementation.
Yeah. Yeah. I really encourage people. It's really a pain, but I'm, you know, I've gone through it where I'll look at labels and educate myself and know mm-hmm. how many grams. So I think everybody should take about, you know, a 2-week period of time mm-hmm. and track every single calorie, every, you know, gram of fat, protein and see what happens. There's some great online calculators.
Yeah.
I've used fitday.com.
Okay,
it's not all that fancy, but I just gravitated towards that one.
Yeah. I like the app wise, like my Fitness Pal is a really easy to use. Like I found that it's nice for just a chunk of time to get a refresher on where you're at nutritionally, and definitely very user friendly. So
yeah,
this is not a plug for my
Fitness Pal. Whatever you use, but just take the time to understand, you know, what is. Because if you don't know, if you think this is happening, but you're getting this result, then if you change something, you don't really know.
Like, right.
So you have to know, make a change, and then see if that's, you know, having the net effect that you're looking for, whether that's to change your body composition, lose a little bit of weight, whatever that is. Very important.
Establish the goal, then move from there.
Absolutely. Yeah.
That's perfect.
And get a baseline for, if you're just starting out as a beginner, get a baseline where you're at in terms of caloric intake, in terms of grams of protein. And then from there, you can adjust accordingly if you need more protein, less protein, that kind of stuff, right?
Yeah,
exactly. I think it's important.
Yeah, and you know, like we work with a lot of high volume athletes, and one of their challenges, whether it's someone in a pool, you know, swimming 30 hours a week, or if it's hockey players, like we work with, a couple NHLers, Dougie Hamilton. One of his big challenges is keeping the weight on. Mm-hmm. You know, well, first off, in the summer, what we do with Dougie is, you know, we have a sleep drink for him. We make sure he's fueled during his workouts. He's, you know, recovering well. And we put a little bit more protein in his diet through, you know, raw. So we want to support his massive training in the summer, because he's usually trying to, you know, gain 8 to 10 pounds in the summer.
Within those 3 months of...
Because the season just basically becomes who loses their gains the slowest.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And... Yeah. Then if during the season, if you're, you know, fueling well during a game, you're not letting that deficit get too large, you're recovering well afterwards, you can keep that on. So it's really important to, you know, fuel well. So that's where looking at the total picture of how many how many calories you're getting in the day, make sure that your total caloric needs are matching, you know, what your, not your needs, but intake is matching what you're burning. Because if you're on the wrong side of it, you're going
to
lose.
Exactly. No, and you can't just rely on the grams of protein to help you recover, because then that's just a very small percentage of your total caloric intake, right?
So exactly.
Recovery comes more from the standpoint of total caloric value versus just the protein, right?
Right.
Yeah. You know, we were talking earlier, a lot of folks, when you're in the gym after, you know, workouts, whether it's CrossFit, it's, you know, just, you know, going to, you know, do some Olympic lifting, they always reach to protein. Everybody knows protein. But there's a little bit of, education that needs to be done, that, you know, carbohydrates are an important part of that. To effectively use that protein, you have to have carbohydrates present. So, you know, looking for a blend, maybe if you're doing strength and conditioning type work, maybe a 2-to-1 blend, 2 carbs to 1 protein. If you're doing more endurance work, like, you know, an Ironman athlete, that's when you're looking at maybe a 4-to-1,
right.
4 carbs to the protein. So,
right.
That's my GoPro just crapping out right there for you guys listening. Walk me through, if I was to approach you and say, listen, Darcy, we'll take for instance, my past in athletics. I mentioned to you that I was a professional dunker for a long time. And after a little bit of explanation a little bit of explanation about what that was. If I approached you and said, Darcy, you know, I've tried every supplement. Like, I've been everywhere. I've tried a bunch of stuff, but I'm looking for something specific to my needs. Like, walk us through the process of dealing with an athlete or dealing with someone that approaches you with a need for a product and how that kind of, works itself out.
Yeah. So, I mean, first of all, we have to, you know, get to know, you as an athlete. It generally starts with, you know, trying to understand your training volume. So, if you're telling me that, you know, I spend, you know, 2 hours, a day, you know, doing, you know, some strength and conditioning work, I know that that's the volume. I sometimes do a little bit longer sessions. It's just really understanding the type of work that you're doing, the intensity that you're going at. So that's one piece. Then we start to talk about, well, you know, what's your sweat rate? And sweat rate isn't as important in, you know, shorter, you know, bursts, like, you know, so you're right. not going to get, you know, severely depleted in a 2 hour session right. compared to someone that's might doing, you know, some cycling or, you know, so it's not as important. We generally, you know, don't get into the sweat analysis too much. What we want to do is just kind of educate you that, hey, we need you to, you know, drink and consume, you know, some electrolytes and, sure. and whatnot, but we're really tailoring the drink to match the intensity that you're going. We really want to get as many calories as we can in you mm-hmm. Without affecting your performance. So we never want to get in the way of performance. So a mm-hmm. swimmer, we can't, because the heart rate when you're swimming, it's going up and down. It gets, you know, into zone four, zone right. five. You can't take on as many calories when you're at that high of a heart mm-hmm. rate. Mm-hmm. You know, so want to understand, you know, what zones you're, you know, playing in and right. make sure that we're just supporting the workout and not getting in the way.
Yeah, I definitely always found, you know, when I would, so practicing for dunking was always different than competing. Obviously competing mm-hmm. was a shorter duration, yeah. Quick bursts and you know, what have you. But I would typically get my conditioning through jump training. So I would go to the gym and spend a good 2 hours worth of full effort jumps to the point where I would be like just drenched in sweat. Yeah. But what I found hard was to be able to consume and to maintain my energy levels throughout that
yeah.
2 hour session. You know, I would try eating protein bars. I would try, but then again, I'm eating protein bars and I knew that it took away from my physical mm-hmm. expenditure because I could almost feel my body digesting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so I don't know if that's something that you keep in mind, obviously, when you formulate.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we want you to get through your given workout, you know, to your fullest, right? Mm-hmm. So if we know that you're getting depleted, you know, and you had told me, hey, yeah, I'm running out of energy near the end. We know that we've got to manage that calorie deficit better than you had been, you know, in the past.
Right.
As I said earlier, when we were explaining, you know, kind of, you know, all liquid diet for Ironman, same is true for just about any athletics. You can get more calories in a safer manner, mm-hmm. You know, with liquids than you can a solid. And the key is really making a blend at the right concentration. So the term that we use is osmolality. Osmolality is just basically the concentration of a liquid. So we have to, every blend that we make that's intended for, whether it's custom or if it's off the, you know, shelf like a jet fuel, they're all lower osmolality, lower concentration than our bodily fluids are.
Sure.
And if that happens, as soon as you take it, your body recognizes, there's some receptors in our gastric system that recognize that, hey, this is low enough concentration, I can let this go to my small intestine. So our stomach is, you know, very intelligent organ right. that
yep.
it holds on to it. You know, and that's where some people get into trouble. You know, if they're, you know, they've taken something too solid, or, you know, too highly concentrated, they have this full feeling, mm-hmm. And you try to take on more, but you can't because I'm full. Well, that's mm-hmm. because your stomach has said, hey, I can't let this go. Mm-hmm. And it's going to recruit fluids from the surrounding tissues until it's dilute enough that it can be absorbed across mm. the small intestine, because it's all very simple science.
Right. Yeah.
It's really basic. If you make something the right concentration, it will be pulled across the small intestine mm-hmm. into our bloodstream, where, you know, our electrolytes, the nutrition that we're taking, and the water is going to do its job.
That can sometimes be overlooked by any, you know, athlete or gym goer. That's often overlooked. Like, I'm just going to have, you know, a protein right. bar before I train, and then
since it's good for workouts, I'll just have it.
Yeah,
yeah.
You know, and then you end up going to the gym, you're all fatigued because you're in digestion mode, and you're not.
Yeah. You're not getting to those yeah. calories. I mean, it's going to be there like a lump,
yeah.
You know, and maybe a little bit after the workout. And maybe that's the intent. That's what the, you know, yeah. that athlete's trying yeah. to do, is they're trying to recover. So they're taking their bar during. But if you want energy during, you have to have energy that gets to your system mm-hmm. during.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. Mm-hmm. Talk to me. So we spoke before the podcast. I came a bit early fussing around with the equipment. And you mentioned that, kind of getting off the topic of the supplement specific, you mentioned that you guys recently received a grant, and a pretty sizable one as well. And can you just touch a little bit on that? Because Mike didn't get to hear about it, and I just kind of want to.
Yeah, we're really proud of it, and we're actually excited to get it going. It's actually just about to start. It was awarded last summer. So we work with a researcher, Dr. Stu Phillips, up at McMaster University. Mm-hmm. He heads up a program there, and he's one of the best, most knowledgeable guy as it relates to muscle.
I heard him speak at the university.
Yeah,
I think so, last year.
Yeah, I didn't get to go. I wanted to be there, but Stu became aware of us. We connected, and we've made some products for studies that he and his teams do. So I think we've done 4 or 5 different studies. And what's cool is we get direct insight to it. We'll probably be noted in when they're published, and we're on the cutting edge of science by involved. So it's been a good relationship. And something came across his desk, about a year and a half ago, and it was a call for research projects for this grant that happens, I think it's every other year. It's On the Podium and MyTax. MyTax is an organization that, partners academia with, private business. And it's usually a matching fund. So a company would come forth and, they would put up $50,000, let's say, and, MyTax would match that. So you have $100,000 to go do a research that you want to do. And it helps the institution because, they've got meaningful things, for, the students to work on. And it helps, obviously, the business because they get, some new science that might differentiate their product. So, the On the Podium program, combined with MyTax, what they were looking for is advances in innovation. It could be in engineering. Mm-hmm. It could be in a host of different things. Of course, our thing is nutrition. So that was one of the areas that, projects could be accepted on. So Stu asked if, I was interested in, putting a letter of intent together. And we did. We got some help from some of the folks that we work with at Canadian Sport Institute.
Nice.
We put together a great project, and it was to deal with, we talked earlier about high volume athletes. So one of the challenges that they have is that energy deficiency, mm-hmm. getting enough energy into, these high volume athletes. So they're overreaching is the term. Mm-hmm. They're trying to create an adaptive response. But if you overreach for too long when it's not supported with nutrition, you can actually go backwards.
Right.
In a nutshell, the program that we put forth is to customize nutrition for during, so that we're managing that deficit, creating a recovery blend that's tuned to each athlete. And then one thing that the Sport Institute wanted, some of the dietitians, Heather and Christine, they're really keen on having a sleep drink. Sleep is where we're fasted, and when we get into REM sleep, that's when growth hormone is most prevalent, mm-hmm. And that's one of the best times
for recovery.
So they wanted a protein, a sleep drink as part of that. So that was part of our proposal. Marty Gabala is a good friend and a partner to Stu. He's part of the research, and we had to have a couple sport organizations mm-hmm. sign on with us, and Swimming Canada signed on, as well as Rowing Canada. Nice. So those two national sport organizations were keen on mm-hmm. Endorsing it, and we got the nod. And what happens is there's a $110,000 grant, and it's really the bulk of it is to pay for the researcher who's Martin McInnes, and we're just getting rolling with it now. So that's really awesome. Excited to
Wow, congrats on that.
Yeah, working with them, and the recognition, it's kind of cool that they think that highly of our organization and what we'll find during the process when we put our minds together. We just have a platform here. We have really good raw materials. We have a custom approach. With their brains, we're going to be able to put some really cool things
That's
together.
That's exciting. I'm looking forward to see what happens.
Yeah, me too.
That's great. Well, Darcy, we touched on a lot of things, and most importantly, we got to know a little bit about you and about what Infinit Nutrition stands for, and we definitely want to have you on the show again just to touch on, obviously, more elements of nutritional supplementation and hopefully get some of your athletes on here as well to share their message because, if I haven't said before, like what we try to do here, obviously, is just give people a platform to spread their message and help hopefully, be conducive for change. And if just one person listens to this and learns something new, I feel like we've really hit our nail on the head. So
yeah, no, it's I mean, I like the opportunity to, you know, talk with you guys and, you know, spread the word. We're not a flashy company, you know, and, you know, it's just, it's basic science, it's nutrition stuff.
Right.
It's not all that complicated. We like to kind of, you know, fill in the gap that people, you know, don't understand. And, you know, and we love supporting the local athletes. And if, you know, we can get them on, you know, maybe Melissa, Lionel, Noel, I think that your viewers and, you know, listeners would, you know, get a lot of value.
We can all learn a lot. Absolutely. Yeah. Now you have a blog.
Yeah.
Where can they find you on the blog?
Our blog is teaminfinite.ca, and on there you'll find, you know, stories from our athletes. You see who we're working with. We just finished a thing 30 days away, you know, where we put up a recipe a day.
And the most delicious photos you've ever seen. Yeah. I was like, hey, Kelly, I'm kind of hungry.
Yeah, Tessa did a great job. She's a former Lancer basketball, you know, national.
Shout out to Tessa.
Yeah, champion. And great to have her on board. And she does a great job in that area. Mm-hmm. So it was her idea 30 days away. And we had so many... you know, recipes come in from our customers, and, you know, not only our customers, but some of the athletes that we work with, and they said, you know, hey, we should do something with this.
Yeah.
So that's, you'll see names littered on all of them. I think there's Noel's Brownie Bites or something. So
perfect.
Yeah.
Give people some reading material. Perfect.
Yeah. Yeah, and I mean, we will talk about any, you know, things that are going on in the community, you know, in, you know, Canada sport, you know, with our athletes, you know, so yeah, it's, you know, we're trying to make it, something that's meaningful to folks. We, have a nutritionist, Andrea Doherty. She just recently came on board. She really liked what she does, and pretty simple approach. So, you know, she's giving us some information on that. So,
Nice. Awesome.
Okay.
Perfect. Well, if you haven't already been here, Infinit Nutrition is located in Windsor at 1540 McDougal. So stop by to the storefront and come and say hi to Darcy and the team here. We want to thank you, Darcy, for being on the show today and sharing a bit of information. And I know there was someone trying to get into the store right now, so we'll wrap things up. So
we have it on lockdown.
You can find Infinit at infinitenutrition.ca or infinitecanada.com. And of course, from here at Full Depth, www.thefulldepth.com. From your host, Tyler Ray of the Full Depth Podcast, on behalf of myself and Handsome Mike, we thank you for joining us today, and we will see you next week.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
I was so nervous when my computer kept crashing and shit.
I'm like, no!